Good evening and warm welcome of everybody to a very special addition to our webinar, which is on Diwali special. And today we are going to share few special picks which we can buy on the day of Samvat 2078, on the day of Diwali. Along with that, we are also going to share market view on the market, and also we are going to discuss about few queries if there are any. Basically, we are bullish on the market, and we are going to present all the ideas to invest with a view of next at least 12 months. If we just go through with the previous year, then in the previous year, the market was, the Nifty was around 12,750-780 levels. And today it is quoting at some 18,100, 18,200, which is approximately 40% higher as compared to its previous close. And even if we go through with Sensex, then it was around some 43,000 levels. Now it is trading somewhere around 60,000. So we can imagine, like, the way we saw the run up in the market, it was completely, completely unexpected. I'm going to say there was like expectation of 10-20%, but not at all 40%. And the market actually rewarded heavily in the year between 2020-2021. And there are like number of factors on which certainly we are going to discuss, and we are going to present those factors. But at such a high level, we need to be extra comfortable or extra confident while investing in the market. Even if something goes wrong in the market, we should be ready to invest more, because see, it's a investment time, and we are going to invest for next 12 months. So for investing in ideas, we need patience, and we also need a lot of like periodical investments. Then only one can gain a lot of money in this market or very good return on their investments. So what is important is patience and also periodic investments. And unfortunately, in India, it is completely missing. If we just go through with the trend of the way like investor investing in the market, they try to invest only on the special occasions, or if there is any euphoric sort of activity or momentum in the market. Otherwise, they try to avoid investing in the market. And that is why we try to give ideas on the on any specific event. If there is like a budget event, then after the budget, we try to give some specific picks. On the day of Christmas, on the day of Diwali, certainly. And that is why like we are like trying our investors to invest. We are trying, we would like to ask our investors to invest periodically and after every specific interval. And then only one can make very good money in the market. It's not that we have seen a vertical run-up in the market. We have seen ups and down in the between the years of 2020 and 2021. But still, at the end of particular period, the market is up 40%. And if the market is up by 40%, that means we can imagine that the stocks, they are either doubled or tripled in last 12 months of time. Now, if we just go through with a few corporates, then I still remember Bajaj Auto, which was like quoting at some 10,000 crore market cap in the year 2007-2008. When the market was completely down, and that time they announced that they are going to split the business between Rajiv and Sanjeev. And that time the market cap was somewhere close to some 10,000 crore. So excluding Bajaj Finance, if we calculate the market cap of this particular Bajaj Group in today's date, then it is close to 4 lakh crores. So you can imagine the way like one can make money in just 12 to 13 years. And the way now the corporates have now gaining the power, Tata's, Birla's, even in fact, Ambani's and Adani even, they are minting money in terms of like the way they have like shown their confidence and the way they kept themselves tightly on the pitch. I think that is now rewarding to them and to investors. So we are of the view that we should look for adding those companies or those ideas where we can invest even at current levels on the day of Muhurat, as well as if there is any correction during the next 12 months of time. So I just would like to and I would like to share a few bases because of that we are bullish on the market. And in that very first, if we just go through with a few bases, then in last 2 years, if we see the overall activity for Indian markets, then India, especially corporates, professionals, they did extremely well. And because of that, we saw such type of resilience in the market. Whenever the market has fallen, the corporates and all these people, they have taken necessary steps. And finally, because of that, they even managed to show a very good numbers on quarterly basis. Again, if we go through with a few other statistics, then economy and sectors, number of sectors, they got good support from the economy, from the government, in terms of PLI schemes, in terms of anti-dumping duty, and also in terms of stimulus. The third wave that the India has managed, India has managed the third wave of the COVID very cleverly, and even the vaccination program. And finally, if we go through with a few of our PSUs where the government is like now very much active. So there, if we see, then the DIPAM has not taken any step which has like hurted to the sentiment. They have taken time. They have not sold any PSU in panic. And after the divestment of Air India, now all the corporates and even investors, they are stunned. And that is why, in fact, number of investors are now looking at our markets to invest, because now they are expecting furthermore divestment in the near term. So all these things are turning positive for our markets. And based on that, we are of the view that there are a number of things which are going to come. And whenever, like in the 12 months also, there was like the meeting of Jackson Hole meeting, when the investors were like very, very like scary that what will happen and what will not. But India has managed, and we saw the market crossing its previous high. So whenever there was like any major event, we saw the market has broken its previous high and managed to sustain above those highs. Now, in the short term, if we see the market, then after hitting the levels of 18,600, we saw steep correction to the levels of 18,000. But now again, it is rebounding. So till the market is not crossing 18,600, we are of the view that the market is going to spend some more time. But one thing is very clear, that currently FIs are selling in the market, but domestic institutions, they are also investing heavily. So we need to give weightage to our domestic institutions also. So broadly, we are of the view that we are bullish on the market, and we should look for investing in top companies, in those companies which are really good in terms of upside potential from current levels, which my team will cover, and the broader economy and broader the trend of the market, Amit will explain in his presentation. So now over to Amit. Amit, now you can take the screen.
Thank you, Shrikant. I will briefly touch on what happened in Samvat 2077. Indian markets created history in Samvat 2077 by hitting new milestones. The Nifty surpassed 18,000 on 11th October, and the Sensex surpassed 60,000 on 24th September, with both indices gaining more than 50% during Samvat 2077. BSE Mid Cap and Small Cap Index also did very well and outperformed the broader indices and gained 75% and 94% respectively. Now, the up move in market was very exceptional considering the country was facing COVID situation and there was lockdown across states. Now, also, one important thing to note here was the rally was very broad-based. There was good participation from FIIs. There was good participation from domestic investors, as well as the retail category wasn't left behind. The retail part, we saw huge number of account opening during this Samvat 2077. And if you look sector-wise, Samvat 2077 belonged to BSE Metals, which was almost up 156%, BSE Realty, which was up 125%, and BSE Power, which was up 115%. Now, I'll briefly touch on the economy. COVID had disrupted the economy very badly in FY21, and we degrew by almost 7.3% in FY21. However, with opening of economy, we rebounded very strongly despite second COVID wave and grew by 20.1% in Q1 FY22. Now, if you look at the latest IMF prediction of GDP growth, India has surpassed China and is expected to grow the fastest by almost 8.5% in 2022. Now let's look at the inflation situation of India. Inflation was peaking in the months of May and June 2021, but if you look at the inflation figures of August and September, it has come down significantly and it is below the threshold level of 6% of RBI. Hence, RBI's Monetary Policy Committee has decided to maintain the accommodative stance on repo rate, and KIE expects RBI to move towards a normalcy situation very shortly. Now, let's look at how the role of government in economy boosting. The successful privatization of Air India recently has raised a lot of hope about privatization of other PSUs as well, and this has been one of the boosters for the broader markets. The FDI flow has always also been very strong in FY21, with FDI flows of over $82 billion compared to $74 billion in FY20. We also saw the latest high frequency indicators have been very positive for the economy. Hence, we can expect the Q2 FY22 GDP growth can be similar to Q2 Q1 FY21. We do not see any challenge to the economy in near term. We are expecting a stable COVID situation in near term, and we expect strong earnings and economic revival. We also expect the economy situation to remain very favorable on the back of favorable demographics and likely multi-year investment cycle by corporates and households. Now, if you look at the global situation, globally, if you see the commodity situation was very, very volatile. We saw commodity prices experiencing a lot of volatility. And in recent time, we saw crude has hit its all-time high of almost $85 per barrel. This primarily came after OPEC Plus decided to stick to its planned output. Even natural gas and coal prices have soared significantly. Amidst fears of default by Chinese giant Evergrande, global inflation and overhang of Fed's tapering stance, which is expected to happen from next month, investor sentiments globally altered between pessimism and optimism. Now, this was just a summary of what is happening globally. Now, going forward, as India advances towards full vaccination, we recently achieved the fate of 100 crore vaccinations and complete opening of the economy. We can expect consumption-driven sectors to outperform in somewhat 2078. Banks can also be in focus with the revival of housing and retail loans. A low interest rate situation can be a booster for real estate sector. While we expect strong performance of construction companies also over the next 1 year on account of government's impetus on infrastructure sector. We are also constructive on the cement sector and capital goods sector. Non-ferrous metals can do well on the back of shortage of supply. And while auto sector may show gradual improvement, we are also positive on IT and pharma. Now, if you look at valuation-wise, at 18,125, Nifty is trading at almost 22 times FY23 earnings of 822, which is a KIE estimates, and 19 times FY24 earnings of 926. We believe these valuations are very rich, and this rich valuations have come primarily post sharp re-rating in the multiples of most stocks from the pre-pandemic levels, and also from the prospect. And this forms a this there is a possibility that there could be a pullback in the market and there could be a situation of modest returns coming from the market. On the basis of our assessment of markets and how we see markets shaping in near future, we have identified 10 ideas, investment ideas for Samvat 2078. I will be sharing a couple of ideas from my side from these 10 ideas. Over to Hindustan Unilever. The first idea that I would be sharing is Hindustan Unilever. Now, if you look at Hindustan Unilever, it's a household name. Like everybody in the country uses some or the other product of Hindustan Unilever. And this company reaches the remotest part of the country. And it is also India's biggest quick-moving customer merchandise organization. And it works in 7 different sections. While it's market leader in home care segment with brands like Surf and Vim. Some of the other brands that Hindustan Unilever has in its portfolio includes Vaseline, Sunsilk, Lifebuoy, Pepsodent, Rin, and Domex. So these brands are very well known in the market and is available across the country. Now, this company, apart from modern trade, hypermarkets, recently the focus of the company has been shifting on e-commerce segment with products available on top e-commerce websites like Amazon, Flipkart, Big Basket, then Grofers, then Nature's Basket. So the company is looking the next wave of growth coming from e-commerce segment. Now, during the last one and a half years of COVID, rural has been driving the growth of the company. But in its recent result and management commentary, the company highlighted that rural has slowed down significantly. And even the raw material situation has been very not so encouraging for the company and also for the sector. And hence, the company is taking very proactive steps to tackle the situation. Despite being a big company, Hindustan Liver was able to deliver very good results for the last many quarters. And the financial performance of the company remains strong even currently. And we expect the trend to continue in future quarters as well, but with some caution, especially on the raw material situation. We remain very positive on the stock and we have a ad rating on the stock with the target price of 2950. We are valuing the stock on the basis of discounted cash flow methodology. So Hindustan Unilever is an ad with a target price of 2950. Next idea from my side is on ITC. We are also very positive on ITC and we have a target price of 275 with a buy rating. Now ITC is very much synonym to cigarette business and this has impacted the company very badly. Now cigarette means there is some environmental, social or governance issue. Now this, so with this ESG problem, there was heavy selling in the stock by ESG compliant investors in the last 2-3 years. And this is one strong reason why the stock underperformed in the last 2 years. Selling was also due to fear of ever increasing taxes on cigarettes by the government. But all this negatives are currently behind us. And recent stock performance vindicates that. The stock has run up from rupees 210 to 275 levels in the last 2 months, but it again came down to 235 levels in the last 1 week of market selling. The company also witnessed a gradual improvement in market conditions post June 21 in cigarette business and reported 30% year-on-year growth in volume in Q1 FY22. And ITC has also launched new brands of cigarette in its core areas. We expect the volume trend in cigarette business to continue for ITC. The FMCG business is also doing very well, and it witnessed 10.4% year-on-year growth in revenues in Q1 FY22, and we expect the trend to continue in future quarters as well. ITC continues to invest very heavily in FMCG segment, especially towards distribution. The domestic leisure segment is also expected to has already picked up since June 21 and expected to remain strong, and which augurs well for its hotel business. Paper board and packaging segment and agri business will also expected to do well, and that also is positive for ITC. Broadly, inexpensive valuation. The company still trades at 8x PE its cigarette business, a strong dividend yield of 5%, and expected strong growth in FMCG segment are the key triggers for the stock. We are now also attributing rupees 10 per share to ITC Infotech, which has scaled up very well. We are valuing the stock on the basis of SOTP, and we arrive at a fair value of rupees 275. We also believe there is a room for re-rating and upgrade of the stock, and we can expect the stock to do well in somewhere 2078. So ITC is a buy with a target price of 275 rupees. That's all from my side. Over to Arun for his take on ACC.
Thank you, Amit. We recently have been hearing, you know, a lot about the amount of infrastructure spend, you know, that the government would be spending going ahead. We also know about how much, you know, efforts have been going on the affordable housing side, and we are recently have been seeing a pickup in real estate segment as well. So in the cement space, we broadly are positive, and we like ACC in that. Just to quick, very quick numbers initially for ACC. See, ACC is basically a key player in the Indian cement business, having a pan-India presence. They have an installed capacity of around 34.45 million tons per annum, and they largely are more focused towards retail, where 80% of their revenues, you know, comes through the retail segment. They have some 17 operational cement plants and some 70 ready-mix concrete plants. These are some of the numbers, you know, on ACC. Coming on to the results, you know, the company already, you know, came out with the results last week, and you know, the third quarter results, if you look at, they actually delivered a relatively good results amid, you know, the multiple cost headwinds that we have seen in the for the cement business. For ACC's Q3, their operating profit was ahead, you know, what we were anticipating, and that was larger because we saw higher than expected prices in a relatively weak demand environment for cement. Generally, the July to September period for cement demand is relatively weak because of monsoons, but the prices were better than expected there. Now, we do see concerns, you know, we talk about escalating cost, but you know, we expect, you know, the cement companies, and in fact ACC would also be able to pass on the price increases, the cost increases, you know, through higher prices. That's largely because the demand is likely to remain robust. The company has also impressively, you know, kept their cost under control despite all the commodity price hike that we have been seeing. The company benefits from the master supply agreement that they have, and also they have a cost, you know, saving initiative under the Parvat, which they initiated this program in 2019 to bring about an efficiency in their optimizing program towards cost. So these, you know, cost benefits is likely to keep the profitability relatively decent for ACC. The demand we talked about is likely to do well. The key demand drivers for the industry are housing, where we are already seeing some pickup. Infrastructure, the government has announced significant infrastructure plans over the course of next many years, and we believe the cement demand would remain robust and strong going forward as well. And we also see pickup in industrial and commercial sectors as well, the investments from those segments as well. Overall, we believe that ACC's expansion plan and also their cost saving projects brings about good growth visibility, and we are looking at around 17% volume growth for the company in this calendar year. And on that, high base, we are again looking at around 8% volume growth next year as well. So that's a decent growth, looking at a significant higher volume growth this year, what we are looking at ACC. In terms of balance sheet, the balance sheet is pretty strong. It's a net debt company. They have, we believe, I think, close to some 7,000 crores of cash on their books. The cash flow is also pretty strong. They are a free cash flow generating company, so pretty strong on the balance sheet front as well. And we like the stock in the cement space also because the valuations are relatively decent as compared to peers. They are trading close to, or we are valuing the stock, in fact, at 9 times on their December 2023 numbers. So in the cement space, we like ACC, where we have a target price of 2550. That's it. Over to Himali.
Thank you, Varun. We have two picks from the banking space. One is ICICI and one is State Bank of India. Viewers must have seen the ICICI Bank results that came out on Saturday. So the results were very strong and very positive, and it has grown 30% YOY, and the operating profit also has grown 20% YOY. The headline NPA numbers have also declined as the recoveries and upgrades were more than slippages. And most of these recovery and upgrades were from the retail sector, which had slipped last quarter. So that is again a positive. They're all granular loans, and the fact that they are recovering as fast as they had slipped shows us the strength of the franchise that it has. The loan book grew 17% YOY, and it was a well-diversified book. It has grown across all segments. The deposits also grew at an equivalent 17% YOY. The NIMs were at an all-time high of 4%, which grossed 10 bips QOQ. This 4% is very much in line of what HDFC shows and what other larger peers show. This is for the first for ICICI, and that's also because of its shift in product mix to retail. As I mentioned, gross NPL declined 25 bips to 4.8, and today the provision cover is 80%. We maintain a positive view on the bank, and we expect further earning upgrades in the stock. Valuations also have room for expansion. It's one of the more expensive stock. Nevertheless, we expect an improvement in price, valuation, and earnings. We have revised our fair value to 900 rupees from 810. Similarly, there is similar stories expected in State Bank of India. While the results are going to come out next week, this is the snapshot of what happened last quarter. We expect a very similar story to what other larger banks have played out for State Bank of India as well. Last quarter, it grew 45% YOY because the provisions declined 15%. NPL ratios were unchanged and restructured book was 0.8%. It had additional provision buffers and a high coverage ratio. Our fair value currently is 550. And we value it at 1.3x adjusted book. I would now hand it over to Jatin for his stocks.
Thank you, Himali. So as Amit started that the BSC Metal was one of the key drivers for the earnings in the from summer 2077 to the start of 2078, we believe that there is a still room left in the metal space, and we currently feel that the non-ferrous would be a better pick as compared to the ferrous stocks. And hence, we have picked Hindalco Industries as our top pick and one of the key pick for the Murat for summer 2078. So we have a buy rating on Hindalco with a target of 565, which indicates near about 19% upside. Now, why we believe that the Hindalco can be a better pick amongst the metal sector, as we are factoring that aluminium as a whole is likely to go into deficit from calendar year 2021, which was earlier we were expecting 2022. Secondly, aluminium prices is expected to remain strong because aluminium to produce.
I think your camera is off.
To produce an aluminium, we require a huge amount of the power, and definitely increase in the power cost recently in the China. So has given a support to the overall aluminium prices. Aluminium prices have gone near about 2,800-2,900 rupees per ton, which augurs very well for the non-ferrous metals, and Hindalco also stands to gain. Secondly, Hindalco, which derived near about more than two-thirds of its EBITDA from the Novelis operation, which which we believe that definitely increasing aluminum prices, the scraps is also expected to go up. So UBC scraps, if you look in August 2021, has beaten new record high, which was led by improved collection rates and the rising aluminum prices. And we believe that rising scrap spreads should keep Novelis margins on an uptrend and will... I've logged in from two camera. So definitely we believe that the strong aluminum price and record margin at Novelis to drive earnings upgrade. We believe that higher spread also suggests that the further sequential margin expansion for the Novelis in the coming quarters. So with the upside risk across India, Novelis, Hindalco offers attractive risk reward in these things. And we value the Hindalco domestic business at 4.5 times September 23 EBITDA and Novelis at 6.9 times and arrive at a fair value of 565. So Hindalco is a buy with a fair value of 565. So that's all from my side. I hand over a call to Pankaj for his take on L&T. Pankaj, please.
Thank you, Jatin. Now I'll take you through L&T. So the stock where we have buy rating and we have a target price of 2100 rupees. We had recommended L&T in our last year's Murat pick. And since then, the stock has given sparkling returns of 90%. So we believe that there's enough steam left in the stock that it can continue to brighten up your portfolio till next Diwali. So L&T, as you are aware, it's a giant in engineering and construction space, and it has a wide presence across verticals, be it roads, airports, power, and it's a direct play on CapEx cycle revival. We believe that L&T would be a key beneficiary from government's impetus towards the infrastructure sector. Central government has recently announced Gati Shakti program, and it's a positive step as it ensures integrated planning and implementation of infrastructure projects of over 100 lakh crore in next 4 years. So it will cover infra initiatives like Bharatmala projects, Sagarmala, Udan, railways, economic zones, and several other projects. So the program provides a stimulus to improve execution of infrastructure jobs. So L&T may consider bidding for more jobs in urban infrastructure space, roads, power, and railways once execution and commercial terms turn favorable through the various corrective measures adopted under Gati Shakti scheme. L&T has been very selective for projects in the past, and it is clearly reflected in its cash flows. So L&T has generated healthy cash flows in the last few years, and it is expected to generate roughly 27,000 crore of free cash flows in next 2 to 3 years. In the last 10 years, L&T has outperformed its peers and it has grown its order backlog by 2.5 times to 3.2 lakh crores. So this gives a revenue growth visibility for next 2 to 3 years. And we believe that it can continue to gain market share based on its balance sheet strength. L&T has reported robust order inflows of 1.7 lakh crore in FY21. And order inflows are expected to gather momentum in the coming quarters, as it has 9 lakh crore of project pipeline from domestic and international market. So at a 15% strike rate, L&T's order book and order inflows can grow at a double-digit rate in FY22. And we believe that L&T can enhance exposure in railways, power sector, and it will de-risk its EPC business in the coming years. So we expect a 17% revenue CAGR and 26% earnings CAGR in its core engineering and construction business in FY21 to 24. L&T is delivering well in terms of margin despite raw material price headwinds, and it can sustain its margin as it has a price escalation clause in most of large part of its order book. So it is largely protected against the commodity price inflation. We reiterate our positive stance on L&T and value the consolidated core engineering and construction business at a 17 times earnings multiple. We have recently increased our sum of the parts based fair value to 2100 from 2050, as there's a increased value coming out from the technology business like Mindtree. So this Diwali, I'll say let's construct your portfolio with L&T for sparkling returns. So that's it from my side. Over to Sumit.
Thank you, Pankaj. I have 3 stock ideas to share with you. First, Infosys Infosys, we are recommending buy with a target price of 2000 rupees, which gives an upside of almost 17%. As we all know, Infosys is a global leader in next generation digital services. We all know that Infosys was established in 1981. In this journey of 40 years, Infosys has achieved multiple milestones and is well equipped for industry leading growth in the medium term. It is in the forefront of core transformation deal of its clients. What does that mean? Everybody talks about that Infosys is doing core transformation. What does it mean? It means the company Infosys is playing a very crucial role when its clients are looking for digital transformation. That means they are considering Infosys is the first player who can help them in moving towards the digital journey. That shows the trust the clients have in Infosys. How Infosys has gained this leadership position? The growth leadership comes on the back of investment in multiple dimensions of business. So the company has invested on capabilities, invested in developing the entire ecosystem, partnership. It has done all possible things to gain market share, deliver best services to its clients, win their trust, which is giving the results today. More importantly, Infosys has outperformed TCS on revenue firm, on the revenue side for third consecutive year. That means the company is growing faster than TCS in terms of revenue. It means that the company has the potential to grow very fast. The company is gaining market share. We expect the company to report double-digit revenue growth for next 3 years. That gives clear revenue visibility. That is why we are pushing this idea to you so that you can invest in the stock and gain good returns from this. We believe the fair value is 2000 based on 30 times September 2023 EPS. When we have so much clarity on the revenue side, then one should invest in this stock from a longer term perspective. The next stock idea from my side is BPCL. We recommend buy on BPCL with a target price of 550 rupees, which is giving an upside of almost 27%. India's second biggest oil marketing company is BPCL. I repeat, it is the second biggest oil marketing company. What does that mean? It means that the company has huge distribution network available with it, which cannot even be created in next 40 years by any new company. That means the value is huge. Currently, the company is getting bullish, is getting benefited with recovery in refining margins, robust marketing margins. We all know the demand has improved globally for refined products. That is leading to better margin for Indian refineries too. There is another hanging fruit in this case, in the case of BPCL, which is the potential value unlocking from privatization. Notably, BPCL's auto fuel growth was ahead of domestic consumption. What does that mean? It means that company is taking market share from others. It is becoming more dominant in domestic market as compared to other players in the market. Marketing margins on auto fuels have remained elevated. So that is the, I will say, icing on the cake, because if you are gaining market share in auto fuels and your marketing margins are also improving, that means you are both hands of you are full with chocolates. Kotak India refining margins have increased in the recent weeks. That means the company is going to get benefited further. We expect earnings to grow significantly in the next 2 years. We value the stock on a sum of the parts valuation method. And we believe the fair value is 550 based on 7 times enterprise value to EBITDA plus the value of its investments like IGL, Petronet LNG and many others. The next stock idea from my side will be Reliance Industries. I don't need to introduce this company. I know we all know this. We have seen it in and out. We are using their products. Reliance is India's biggest company in terms of market cap of around 17 lakh crore rupees. Reliance was incorporated in the year 1973 that itself shows that it has bellwethered all possible ups and downs, and it is in a position to take care of its future. We can remain invested in the stock because the promoter knows how to run a company. It is in the business since 1973. It is operating in diversified sectors. It drives revenue from oil and gas business, refining, petrochemical, telecom, retail, e-commerce, and whatnot. We believe near-term triggers for the company to benefit are recovery in refining, launch of JioPhone Next, possible hike in telecom tariffs, anticipated strong growth in retail business. What is happening in Indian economy is that the entire unorganized market is moving to organized market. So big players like Reliance, Flipkart, Amazon is trying to gain that market. We believe the market size is huge. There is a possibility for growth for all of the players. If somebody is investing hugely and doing the right steps, then they will gain the market share very fast as compared to its peers. Reliance Jio has commenced 5G trials, which means it is ahead of the curve. We expect telecom business revenue to grow on account of both higher subscriber base and rise in blended ARPU to 168 rupees per month. On the oil and gas segment, the company will benefit from gas production from MG field. So this will be incremental volumes which will be coming at a higher price because the government has recently increased the domestic prices, gas prices. So the company will get benefited because of higher volumes and higher realizations. Company has guided for 30 MMSCMD of gas per day volume in calendar year 2023. Our fair value for Reliance Industries is 2,800 rupees. We recommend investors to add this stock in their portfolio. All dips should be used to accumulate these stocks from a long-term perspective. That's all from our side. These are the good stock ideas which we have shared. Now I hand over the dice to Rini.
Thank you, Sumit and team, for the insightful presentation. We will now open the floor for questions. For Q&A sessions, dear viewers, you can ask your questions in the comment section below. Thank you. Starting with the first question, what is your view on real estate sector? Which are the stocks to buy at current levels? Pankaj, can you please unmute yourself and answer this question?
Sure. So real estate, if we see, the stocks have rallied, no doubt. And in past 1 month, it has rallied around 15 to 20%, and even last 6 months, it has rallied over 40%. In our view, the momentum in the real estate volumes and coupled with the market share gain continue to surprise positively. And our analysis says that the peak sales of the real estate was roughly 65 crore square feet in FY13. And in FY21, we clocked 50 crore square feet. So we are still far behind what we had in FY13. So there is enough potential to grow the sales volume in the coming years. So because there are multiple factors which can drive the sales growth, the low interest rate environment, which is and improved affordability, this will continue to drive the sales momentum in the residential real estate sector. Even the market share of the larger real estate companies have grown, and it has increased from 9.2% in FY18 to 10.5% in FY21. So there is a consolidation theme which is playing on in the real estate sector, and we believe that the listed players will continue to gain market share. In terms of preferred picks, we continue to prefer Bangalore-based companies because of their superior sales reporting, which they have delivered in the last few quarters, and we continue to like Brigade, where we have a buy rating of with a 500 rupees fair value. We like Shobha with a fair value of 880 rupees, and Prestige, where we have ad rating with a 510 rupees. In Mumbai based, among the Mumbai based real estate players, we like Lodha, the macro tech developers, where we have a fair value of 1260, and we also like Suntech, where we have a buy rating with 530 rupees target price. So these are all stocks we can play. In the retail based real estate theme, we continue to like so in the retail side, you can always bet on Phoenix Mills. That's our preferred pick, and we like that stock. Thank you.
Thank you, Pankaj. Next question is it good time to sell pharma stocks, or should we continue to hold? Purvi, can you share the outlook?
Yes, thank you for the question. So on the pharma sector, we feel that for the near term, there can be a couple of hurdles, namely one being that the logistic costs, the raw material costs, and the transportation costs are creating a bit of a pressure on the margins. On the domestic front, we do not see much of a issue because the Indian pharma market in itself has been growing at around 10 to 12%, and most of the pharma companies are either in line with the market growth or they are above the market growth. In the US, a couple of companies are facing some pricing pressure. That's mainly on account of the delayed approvals from the US FDA's end, and also FDA has now started inspecting plants. So that also can be something which needs to be looked at. So we feel that for a longer term horizon, one can be selective and hold on to good companies, names like Cipla, Sun Pharma. They can hold on to the stocks for a long term horizon. For the near term, yes, there could be pain. So holding on to stocks is a better idea, and adding on debts wherever there's more of a conviction in terms of having good management, good balance sheet and business model can give you better returns over long term.
Thank you, Purvi. Next question is, can you please share your outlook on IRCTC? Arun sir, would you like to answer this question?
See, IRCTC as a stock has been in limelight in the past couple of months. We have seen significant volatility in the stock price. Broadly, if you look at IRCTC, the business model, the company operates broadly in four segments, which is internet ticketing, catering, packaged drinking water, and travel and tourism. The overall business model for the company remains the same. However, the market now, if you look at markets, the markets are looking at the online businesses probably in a different way, as it was looked pre-COVID. And accordingly, there has been a lot of interest seen on online businesses. Now, IRCTC operates on a monopoly business. Hence, we have seen significant interest. Another factor possibly for the steep volatility in the stock price could have been the stock split news in the company, which will be happening this week. Overall, IRCTC, we believe that we could wait for the time being, let the stock settle because it has been very volatile in recent times. And hopefully, this IRCTC is more of a economy opening theme, where post-COVID economy would open up and yet things would resume to the normalcy level. So maybe for the time being, we could, just let and see, stock settle a bit. In the near time, the stock could be volatile, could be a bit riskier. And yes, from a longer term perspective, IRCTC is a good stock, we believe, to hold. One risk factor that I would like to highlight for IRCTC is that it's a regulatory business. So any change in government regulatory policy, this is one thing we need to watch out for IRCTC for a longer term.
Thank you, Arun. Next question is, Berger Paints or Asian Paints, which is good? Amit sir, would you like to answer this?
Both companies have been doing very well of late. Like, if you see, Berger Paints has not announced their numbers yet, but if you see the Q2 FY22 quarterly numbers of Asian Paints, they have reported very good top line numbers, but they were not able to hike prices of their products primarily because Grasim is foraying into paint sector. So just to keep competition at bay, this big players like Berger Paints and Asian Paints, they are not able to increase their prices. So they are more focusing on top line growth and And if you see the operating margins of this company has fallen down from 20% to 12%. So they have taken significant hit on operational performance just to keep competition at bay coming from Grasim. This is one thing. And second thing, already these companies are trading at very rich valuations. So even if the quarterly performance has been very good for this company, we would like investors to stay away from these stocks primarily on valuation concerns. These stocks are already trading at 60 times, 70 times FY23, FY24 earnings. So we would, at this juncture, we are neither recommending Berger Paints or we are neither recommending Asian Paints. We have a reduced rating on both the stocks.
Thank you, Amit. Next question is for Sumit. Outlook on Petronet LNG.
See, Petronet LNG got impacted in the recent past because of the rise in international gas prices. What happens when your spot LNG prices rise significantly? The demand for gas reduces because a lot of players or the consumer industries may not like to go for spot gas prices. That impacts the volume growth for Petronet LNG. However, we believe that this is more of a seasonal phenomena and it happens every year. This time it has happened because of strong winters expected in developed countries like Europe and US. That has led to sharp increase in spot LNG prices. We believe this will cool down in a month or so. After that, the spot LNG prices will come down. That will again be quite positive. As I mentioned that these are seasonal factors. So we believe that this, when the stock corrects because of these seasons, the stock should be bought from a longer term perspective. We remain bullish on Petronet LNG. We believe the fair value is 275 rupees. Another important aspect to Petronet LNG is that BPCL is expected to get privatized, and BPCL's hold a significant stake in Petronet LNG. That is 12.5% stake. What will happen to that stake? Market is also worried about it. But my take is that government will either ask other PSUs like GAIL or other players to take their stake or some other companies to take or any other PSU company to take their stake. This will not be sold to any private players. This is my take, because if the 12.5% stake is sold to any private company, then Petronet LNG will become a private company rather than a government company. So this will not happen. So we remain very bullish on Petronet LNG with a target price of 275 rupees, which gives a decent upside of almost 20%.
Thank you, Sumit. Next question is from the auto sector. What are your views on Tata Motors, given good run in passenger and commercial vehicles, and also JLR Land Rover recovering in China, which is the big market for the company? Arun sir, would you like to take this up?
Yeah, I'll take that. See, Tata Motors as a stock has done phenomenally well in the past one and a half year. The reasons, yes, has been because they have done pretty well in the domestic market. The commercial vehicle industry, which has been in challenging times before COVID, has also now gradually seeing recovery happening there. JLR is one business, you know, where we have to be a bit cautious on Tata Motors now, and that's largely to do with the entire industry moving towards the electric vehicle space. So you have to wait and watch how the company's, you know, products do in the market. But another big positive for Tata Motors in recent times have been the TPG investment in the EV space along with Tata Motors. So that's been a big positive. Tata Motors has taken a lead in terms of electric vehicles here in India. And overall, we are positive on the space. We are positive on Tata Motors. But given that the stock has already rallied significantly in the past 1.5 months, maybe we could look at corrections on adding the stock. Overall, we are expecting that the financial performance of Tata Motors would see improvement in the coming years.
Thank you, Arun. Next question is for Amit sir. Can you share your views on Marico? Can you please unmute yourself, sir? Amit sir. Amit sir, can you share your views on Marico?
Yeah. See, Marico, they have not announced their Q2 FY22 numbers yet, but if you see the copra prices has been increasing for the last 3 quarters, and this is one strong reason that the company has taken a hit on operational performance. Also, if you see, the product portfolio is very limited for the company, and despite weak operational performance, the stock has rallied a lot in the last 2-3 months, and currently we have a reduced rating on the stock, so we are not very bullish on Marico.
Thank you, Amit sir. Next question is from the pharma sector. Can you share your outlook on Lupin? Purvi, can you please unmute yourself and answer?
So on Lupin, currently we have a buy rating, but I would also like to highlight that the company's five of their manufacturing units are having some issues with the US FDA, where they are either having a warning letter or having an official action indicated status, or having a 483 form that is pending to be resolved. So I feel that even if the valuation wise, even if the stock is inexpensive, but news flow in terms of what is the resolution that comes out on this plans can swing the stock either which ways, depending on the kind of a positive or a negative news flow. The company will also announce their results tomorrow, and they'll have a management call. So the outlook and the commentary is something that we look forward to also. Thank you.
Thank you, Purvi. Next question is for Hemali. Can you share your views on LIC Housing Finance?
We have a buy rating on LIC Housing Finance. However, we believe that it will take a couple of more quarters first to stabilize. This quarter, it took an NPV hit on a book that it restructured, and that was quite a large NPV hit. In the longer term, we expect the real estate cycle and the movement in real estate cycle to benefit LIC Housing Finance. However, the current stock of gross NPA is a little high on the higher side, and we expect some higher provisions in the near term. We currently have a buy rating on the stock on its cheaper valuation and medium-term real estate outlook.
Thank you, Hemali. Next question is for Purvi. Purvi, can you share your views on Tata Power?
So on Tata Power, we currently have a sell recommendation with a fair value of 190. Now, why we have a sell reco is mainly because of the extreme coal price movements, which keep on adding twist to the coal equation, and also the sustenance of high coal margins remains questionable. Also, at the current coal prices, the cash losses at Mundra, which is one of its projects, would come to around 2,400 crores. So we feel that the inability to ramp up the business and renewable portfolio may also lead to derating. And also recently the flooding in Shanxi, which is in China, had disrupted the coal prices, and the benchmark prices have gone up quite a bit. So the option of selling the coal at exchange at market price was also less feasible. So we feel that the monetization of the renewable assets, although has come into spotlight, one needs to look how it goes on. So we've downgraded to sell with a revised fair value of 190. Thank you.
Thank you, Purvi. Next question is for Jatin. Can you share your views on Coal India?
So Coal India, yes, we have seen decent volatility in the Coal India because of the what's happening in China, and domestically also the price is going up. We believe that yes, Coal India, one can look basically as a dividend play from a long-term story. Definitely all the PSUs of late is in focus because of the divestment that's going to happen and the dividend which the all the PSUs is expected to announce in their forthcoming results. But we believe that beyond that numbers, we still feel that the Coal India earnings is expected to go up. Definitely the volume in past have been a bit muted. And the last quarter was also we are muted because of the monsoon season. But however, we expect volume to pick up in the time to come. So we believe that yes, Coal India definitely can be a dividend play. If one wants to hold it for a longer period, they can look at buying the stock at the every day.
Thank you, Jatin. Next question is for Arun, sir. What are your views on Hero Motor Corp?
On Hero, we don't have really have much upside here as to our target price. If you look at the two-wheeler space, now there are two things we have to look. One is the current demand environment, which in the domestic market, the two-wheeler demand is relatively a bit subdued currently. And the other thing we have to look, the two-wheeler space also from the electric vehicle space, as Ola has already launched their product. And, you know, we'll see EVs coming rather quickly in the two-wheeler space in the coming years. So from when we look at the current demand perspective, the demand, as we talked about, is relatively a bit weak. Hero has majority of the sales coming in from the domestic market, and we really don't have much upside from the current levels where our target price stands for Hero. In fact, in the two-wheeler space, we like Bajaj Auto currently, where we have a target price of 4650. That's a long-term target. Bajaj, if you look at, they have around 50% of the revenues coming in from export markets. So that's relatively hedged when we talk about EVs coming in the domestic side. They also have presence in the three-wheeler space. And they are actually, you know, not being present in the internal combustion engine to scooter space. They launched an electric EV in the scooter. And so we believe this could also be an opportunity for the company where, you know, they didn't have any market share earlier. So if they get the products right and, you know, good acceptability in the market, that could also help them, you know, gain some market share in this EV space in the scooter side, which has been lagging from the company in the past few years. So yeah, in the two-wheeler space, TVS is again a decent story in terms of growth. However, the valuations, if you look at, is relatively higher when we compare with both Hero and Bajaj. So in the entire two-wheeler pack, we recommend Bajaj Auto at this point in time for long-term investors.
Thank you, Arun. Next question is on pharma sector. Should I sell or hold Cadila and Biocon? Purvi, would you like to take this up?
Yes. So on Cadila, I'd like to say is that the stock had run up mostly on the basis of news flow regarding to their COVID vaccine. So it has been stating that their vaccine is more for the kids in the age of 12 to 18, and they've received the government approval also. But so mostly it was a news flow talk, so because of which the stock had reacted quite positively, and people were very thankful about it. But I feel that now that the government has also stated that the kids can go for a co-vaccine as a vaccine for kids as well, so that really turned out to be a bit of a negative for the stock, and the stock has been corrected. So I would rather suggest to switch from this stock to stocks like Cipla and Sun Pharma, where we have long-term surety in terms of business and management and balance sheet. When it comes to Biocon, the numbers for this quarter were more or less in line with expectation. One of the key things that stand out during the quarter was that they had recently received an interchangeability status for their their insulin product simply. So this can be a good positive for the stock, but one needs to be very careful because the company has in the US not been able to gather much market share for their two of their key products, Wipila and Opvee, where the market share has been stagnated to high single digits, that is around 8-9% for since a couple of months. So one needs to see the execution and if their products can gather the kind of market share that we are expecting, then yes, of course, it can be a little bit of a better outlook. But at the moment, we have a sell record on the stock with the fair value of 300 rupees.
Thank you, Purvi. Next question is, please share your views on IRB. Pankaj, would you like to take this up?
Yeah. So IRB, if you look at, this is a pure play BOT player, and they develop the road and projects, and they collect the toll. So the earnings basically are back-ended in this kind of business. And currently, if you look at the bidding from the NHAI is largely on the EPC and the HAM side. Of course, the some BOT projects comes where IRB is well-placed because the competition on the BOT side is quite low. They have some of the good projects like Mumbai Pune Expressway and all in them. So in terms of valuation, I believe the stock is trading above its fair value, though we are positive on the stock because it has delivered a good execution capability in the BOT project side, which very few other companies could have delivered. So on IRB, we can look at the stock on decline only.
Thank you, Pankaj. Dear participants, thank you for the wonderful response. We will only be able to take a couple questions more. So next question is, can you tell best stocks from mid-cap IT space for next 2-3 years? Sumit sir, would you like to take this up?
Yeah, please. See, we believe that Mphasis has got a lot of potential to grow. One, that stock which we like a lot. We suggest investors to look not just mid-cap, don't get carried away with mid-cap, large-cap. Just look at the potential which companies can grow faster. We believe that Infosys is one stock which you should hold in your portfolio. Another stock is Tech Mahindra, where we are extremely gung-ho. The company is just doing extremely good work on the telecommunication side, and the potential to grow is huge. So Tech Mahindra also you can focus on. Another stock which is L&T Technology Services. This is more of an IT engineering company. But considering that the huge demand coming for autonomous cars, EVs and other things, this company has the potential to deliver a strong, robust growth going forward. So we remain extremely gung-ho on L&T Technology Services also. So these stocks you can look from a longer term perspective.
Thank you, Sumit. Next question is from the metal sector. What is your take on current weakness in metals? What should be the strategy? Jatin, would you like to take this up?
Yes, I'll do that. So definitely metals, I mean, after a rally, we have seen a certain profit booking. But we believe that there are certain pockets where we still feel there is a still room and the steam left for the upside and the earning upgrade. And we believe that the non-ferrous, like a base metals, are better place as compared to the ferrous. Because on the steel, we believe that the whatever strong operating performance that we have seen in the past, more or less the margin has been picked, and we'll probably see a moderation from the Q2 or second half of FY22 onward as high cost of coking coal will start flowing in. But however, on the other end, if you look aluminium zinc, because of the higher power cost and supply issues in China, we believe that these base metals are expected to remain strong in the near term. And that will be the one of the bet as compared to the ferrous. And that's why Hindalco is one of the top pick, and we have selected it for the Murat. So after Hindalco, one can definitely look at Vedanta Nalco as a packing order. And in steel, if anyone wants to have a pick, then definitely Tata Steel and JSPL can be a preferred bet.
Thank you, Jatin. Thank you, all the viewers. We now close the floor for Q&A. I request Shrikant sir to give the closing comments. Shrikant sir, over to you.
Yeah, thank you, Rini, and wonderful presentation. Thank you, everyone. The way you have like explained these stocks, one thing is very clear that now there is no doubt in the minds of investors that where to invest and why to invest. So everything you people have explained in detail, and I'm very much sure the way like you're going to spend on this Diwali, because after say like after almost 1.5 years, you're going to spend and you're going to shop. So at least spend some more money on shopping stocks also. And there are like number of ideas, and we need confidence. So that already we have given. Now you need faith to invest in these companies. keep investing in good companies on every dip. Along with the overall this presentation, I would like to add a few more things. And one thing is that, see, this particular pandemic made realize the world that they cannot rely on only one manufacturing industry country. So now they have again started looking for other potential areas where they can go for their manufacturing plants and all. So which is certainly positive other than China. Also, if we go through with the way there is an implementation of GST and MPC, I'm going to say RBI's monetary policy, it is helping to corporates and to the emerging India. So it's a great combination. And if I go through with the way India is like facing almost all the difficulties and they are overcoming all the difficulties, one thing is very clear that for next 10 years, we are going to enjoy the benefit of economies the way China has enjoyed from 2000 to 2010. So I think now the era of India had started, and if you like still start investing in either on even if you go for SIPs or for direct stocks, then also it's fine. But one thing is very clear that we have to start investing confidently in this market, and then only like we can make very good returns on our investments. All these things on which like I would like to finally give lots of best wishes for this particular Diwali, and happy Diwali, Shubha Deepavali to all of you from me and from my entire team. Thank you very much for attending to for keeping patience and listening to us.
Thank you, Shrikant sir.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.